Okay, good morning, everyone, and you're very welcome to this edition of the Coffee Microcaps Morning Meeting. I'd like to welcome any of our returning regular attendees and any of our new attendees who are joining us from this morning session. You're very welcome. My name is Mark Tobin. I'm the founder of Coffee Microcaps. I'm just going to run through a couple of intro slides here, and then we're going to get straight into it with this morning's company. Firstly, I'd like to thank our sponsor for all our virtual events here, Coffee Microcaps, RAS Research as a Service. If you are looking for some independent research on small and microcap companies listed on the ASX, and the team at RAS cover, I think, about 20 different names at this stage, quite a few who have presented here at Coffee Microcaps, either in the webinar format or indeed at some of our live events over the last 12 or 18 months. Be sure and check out their website. There might be a few names there that you could be interested in. A quick compliance and disclaimer slide for any of our friends from ASIC who might be joining us this morning. You're very welcome. In terms of the companies, if you're new here, are presenting here on a kind of a regular basis, generally kept under 300 million companies that are in revenue, cash flow break even or thereabouts, or indeed are already profitable. We generally don't tend to have companies from the resources or biotech sectors on these morning meetings, what I like to call industrial microcaps, which kind of covers basically all the other sectors: healthcare, technology, professional services, and pure industrial companies. Structure this morning's webinar. We didn't get a second company in this morning, but we have one company joining us, which we will get to shortly. It's going to be 30 minutes, which we're going to break down into a 20-minute prezo and 10 minutes of Q&A. If you do have any questions, please type them in the Q&A box rather than the chat function in your nav bar. Just makes it easier for me to moderate the questions to our presenter. And please note the webinar is being recorded and it will be posted on the Coffee Microcaps YouTube channel tomorrow morning. You can follow us pretty much on all the socials: Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn. I mean, as I mentioned, YouTube for the recording of this event. And indeed, we've probably got about 200 company presentations up on the YouTube channel going back over the last 4 years for anybody who wants to check that out. And I do write a free monthly newsletter that comes out in the first week of every month. I'm delighted to be welcoming back Joe Foster from Close the Loop Limited. Joe, I'm going to stop sharing yours, or my screen, sorry. And if you want to start sharing yours, we will get going with your presentation. So let me just take that down quickly and I'll let you know when I can see yours coming up.
Yep. Hopefully you can see the screen.
I can, and if you just want to, yeah, play from the beginning, Joe, and it'll should go to full screen. But yeah, that looks perfect, Joe. You can take it away.
That's fantastic. First of all, Mark, thank you very much, and a very warm welcome to all of our attendees. Much appreciate the opportunity to present Close the Loop this morning. So, first of all, maybe just to run through what we'd like to cover this morning. First of all, how Close the Loop fits into the circular economy. We'll talk about some of our strategic growth opportunities, certainly looking across the geographical breakdown. And of course, a very interesting case study by our largest OEM, HP. So if we look at the circular economy, I mean, the problem around circular economy from a global perspective, I think certainly when we look at it, there's only really a small percentage of consumer electronics that are actually used itself. And what we find is that the major OEMs are very ambitious with regards to their ESG targets. And really very ambitious around trying to increase their circularity within the economy from a global perspective. I think we find that all the OEMs need to partner to find a solution within this circular economy model. And we see Close the Loop as the ideal partner to forefront this within a global perspective. From a packaging point of view, it's quite sad to even think about it. I mean, this comment's been around for quite some time that there'll be more plastic in the ocean than seafood by 2050. I think we look at 95% of disposable plastics value is really lost after its use and is eliminated roughly $100 billion annually. I think scary is the fact that health issues now are becoming quite clear with regards to scientists finding microplastics quite recently in 2022 in human blood for the first time. And that's something that we need to address in terms of the type of plastic and the type of packaging that we're putting out to the market itself. How does the circular economy work for closed loop, and how does closed loop actually work? And what we try and do is we put it in true perspective around the true circularity. We see our business really as a company that collects consumer electronics, anything from laptops to gaming devices to desktop printers. We collect print consumables, we collect cosmetics, soft plastics, batteries, we collect e-waste, a whole number of products. And what we do is we actually refurbish these products and put them back into circularity. Essentially, what we cannot recover or remanufacture, we physically recycle. And what we do with the recycling of these products is either ending up as a commodity-based item, or sometimes we take the raw materials from the recycling aspect of it and make other products that we can put back into circularity. We've got a global reverse logistic network, but probably touch points in excess of 300,000, with 200,000 collection points in North America, 60,000 in Australia, and about 40,000 plus across Europe, which I'll talk about later on. We're in the process of remanufacturing more than 500,000 consumer electronic products per year. And that's increasing when we start looking at the new products that we're bringing into our facilities in North America. We process, in fact, I think it's now over 30 million now print consumables per year. And that's growing certainly as a result of what we're doing across the European market. And the nice thing about it is that what we actually physically cannot repurpose or recover, we actually recycle it through our various different facilities around the world, whether it's North America, Europe, or Australia. And I think what's quite important to point out is that the business model around closed loop was found on a zero waste to landfill policy, and therefore circularity is quite important for our business. If we go back over the last year, in fact, looking at the big strategic move that we took place in North America with regards to taking on ISP Tech Services, it'll be a year at the end of April. And what it's done for the closed loop business, certainly it's repositioned our company as a circular economy leader in the US, which is obviously the world's largest market. We've delivered on the revenue and, of course, EBITDA for the first half ahead of our expectations and would like to continue to do so, certainly for the second half year. And we certainly, what it's done for us is provided access to the world's largest OEMs. And with that in mind, it's obviously given us a very deep and broad partnership. And at this moment, taking discussions with the large OEMs about their circular economy program. And of course, it's opened up significant opportunities with geographical areas, not just in Australia or in Europe, but other parts of the world where we can take the relationship that we have with the OEMs and expand our program into other areas. If we take ISP out of it and look at the core business, let's call it the traditional closed loop business, certainly has produced very strong cash flows and still do, certainly over the last 2 years plus since we listed back in December 2021. We've made a significant investment into resource recovery. In fact, quite recently, we just opened up our new plant in Melbourne, and that's producing a product called Tonoplast and also significant growth into the ITAT area. Quite recently, in fact, over the last 6 months, we launched our pan-European multi-vendor collection program into multiple countries into Europe. And we certainly maintained our EBITDA in the packaging sector, despite the challenges that we are faced with regards to some of the areas around shipping delays and so forth. I think everybody's familiar with our numbers, but I think it's also quite just important to point out for our first half year, our revenue was sitting at 106 and EBITDA at 22.7. If we compare the previous corresponding period, we had a revenue of 58.6 million. And an EBITDA of 9.5 million. So what it's proving really is that we have delivered in terms of integration on the numbers, and certainly are poised to perform based on the guidance that we put forward for our FY24 year. Just breaking down the revenue by geographical areas, I think it's quite interesting. I'm sure most of you know that we're spread across four different geographical areas from a a perspective of closed loop, whether it's manufacturing or whether it's collecting or whether it's supplying plastics materials. Obviously, Australia, America, Europe, and South Africa. If you look at just looking at the American business itself, where it represents 59% of our total revenue. And in fact, when we went to the market back in December 2021, we did specify that we saw opportunities from a strategic perspective to be more positioned in North America, particularly within the resource recovery area. So at the moment, we're looking at about a $63 million revenue we would expect from the North American market, and that's really predominantly from resource recovery. And that is really with regards to our process where we have the 30-day returns program on the consumer electronics, working with the large OEMs like HP. We've obviously got multiple OEM relationships across the print consumables. In fact, we work with probably the majority of the OEMs, and these are the original equipment manufacturers, companies like Xerox, Lexmark, Brother, Canon, Toshiba, and so forth. We've obviously got the three-year revenue sharing program with HP, which we introduced back in the November 2023. And of course, we've got a plastic recycling business, which has now just recently picked up as a result of the prices of the raw materials are now in demand, which is quite positive from our perspective. Looking at the opportunities, certainly in the short term and the medium term growth, we're working obviously with OEMs deeper into the consumer electronics and looking to try and get involved in the next level life cycle of 1-year-old, 2-year-old, and 3-year-old products, where we can develop a refurbishing program for a whole set of consumer electronics. We want to look at expanding the cross-selling existing OEMs relationship from print consumables naturally into the consumer electronics. And of course, we want to add new OEM product lines to our existing facilities in North America. And in fact, we saw some products coming through quite recently as an example, the high-end conferencing facilities under the brand name Poly, which is a product that HP took on quite recently, and now we brought that into our refurbishment program in South Lake Dallas. And of course, we want to grow plastic recycling volumes in North America. We see a great opportunity as a result of what we do in Australia, where we go to the market offering plastic and packaging, and where we have the ability to take it back and do the physical recycling. If we look at the Australian business, certainly predominantly the packaging business. However, we from a resource recovery, we work with all the print consumables across multiple OEMs in Australia. And the soft plastics processing plant that I mentioned a few minutes ago, recently commissioned and installed, where we have the ability to produce 5,000 tons per annum. And I think that's quite interesting to note, is that we can actually take in about 3,500 tons of soft plastics. We take the toner powder and other key ingredients, and we make a product called Tonoplast. We also can make a product called Orflex, which actually goes back into the market. So we would see the opportunities, of course, going into the future with regards to certainly medium-term and short-term opportunities, particularly within that space where we can roll it out across other sectors into the Australian market, looking at Queensland, South Australia, and, of course, New South Wales, where we could increase the capacity quite significantly. And of course, we want to leverage our existing OEM relationships to expand the ITAD sector. In fact, we're very active with one of the largest OEMs around the world on a program here in Australia as a result of our relationship with ISP, where we're actually developing and taking on board the refurbishment, or certainly the stripping out of servers in some of the main data centers across Australia. And of course, what's very important for us is that we are now looking at how can we develop circular contracts. And circular contracts are quite important in terms of taking away complex materials or complex waste materials. In the past, it was very simple. People paid to have waste removed, and then essentially it was out of sight, out of mind. What we're doing now in terms of starting with the soft plastics, we're saying is, of course, we will take your 2,000 tons, your 3,000 tons. But what's quite important is that not only are we charging a revenue for taking the plastic in, as an example, we will then say it's important for you to have a contract with us where you'll take back from us, whether it's packaging or whether it's Tonoplast for your asphalt additive, or it could be what we call Orflex, which is plastic for injection molding. And that's already been well received, so much so that we work with some of the councils across Australia, one council in particular, which is the Bendigo City Council, where they provide us plastic. They take back the same amount of volume we take in for a ton of plastic. We look at the South African market, which is quite interesting. Predominantly, it's a packaging business. And of course, looking at the opportunities into the future, we want to obviously look at increasing our sales volume by expanding our packaging servicing offering. And that's very much around sustainability. But we've got great opportunities in the South African business to expand the resource recovery, looking at ITAD, refurbishment, and certainly looking at the ability to bring in the work around taking on service and so forth. So naturally, if you look at the traditional closed loop business, naturally for us, it's an easy step to take the traditional closed loop business around print consumables, and of course into the ITAD space, into the South African market as well. And again, we look at the European market, which is very interesting. Of course, that's resource recovery business. And we work, again, with most of the OEMs across different geographics in Europe. And the opportunities there is really, and we spoke about this nearly a year ago when we took on the ISP business, was to expand that business model across into Europe. We are very active with that. In fact, I think the first processing will be due to take place initially with printers. We're working with some of the OEMs, in fact, not just one OEM, so certainly multiple OEMs. And soon, in fact, I think it's within weeks, we are just about to embark on the ITAD opportunities across Europe. And of course, when we start talking about ITAD opportunities, we're not just talking about servers, which is one significant part of the business, but certainly opportunities around your consumer electronics, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year end of life products that we have the ability to take in and look at refurbishing as well. And quite recently, as I mentioned, we launched a multi-vendor print consumable program across Europe, and we are now adding some more major OEMs to that program. We launched it back in November, initially into the Benelux area, Germany and the UK. From the 1st of May, we're bringing on two major OEMs. We're looking to launch into Spain, Portugal, France, and Italy. And then within the next 6 months, we will have the whole of Europe being covered. And that is very much around the certainly the regulatory tailwinds and certainly the regulation around electronic products, which is your consumer electronics or whether it's print consumables, up to 40% have to be refurbished or remanufactured by 2025. We got together with all the OEMs in the space around print consumables and, of course, started to talk about consumer electronics. And so much so that we launched this program to work with, certainly with most of the OEMs to collect their products. And we see a great opportunity. And already we've seen the revenue increase in the European market. So we would see Europe being in a very strong position to be certainly a similar size to what North America is, and when we start looking at our ability to grow our consumer electronics. We've been asked this question that where do we see the growth? Where will we see the value of the growth around consumer electronics? And we've said that certainly we would see, you know, within 2 or 3 years, there's no reason why we couldn't double the size of our business in terms of the consumer electronics in the North American market. And that's just looking at it from a geographical perspective, certainly Europe, Australia, and other areas that we've already spoken into. Looking at one of the case studies, and certainly, you know, there's no secret that we work with what we believe is the largest OEM in North America, and particularly in the sector that we work with in terms of consumer electronics. And this is actually an interesting point, which is very high on their agenda with regards to not only importance for HP, but certainly for all of their stakeholders, that circularity is key for HP. And this is actually taken from their HP matrix, ESG matrix. And they're saying that by 2030, they want to refurbish or remanufacture anything up to 70% of all consumer electronics. And they want to have those repurposed between 2 and 3 times. And who is the ideal partner to help them, take them on this journey? And it's actually, we believe, Closed Loop in that position to take them along that particular journey. Not only are we well embedded, certainly with HP, with regards to the circularity program, with regards to the customer returns, but we have the facilities and we have the know-how, and we believe that we can take HP. In fact, we're talking to HP at high levels to talk about what is the next program with regards to HP Renew. And just some of their targets, obviously quite ambitious in terms of what they want to do, but just pointing out a couple of interesting points, is that they want to reach 75% circularity for their product by 2030. They've got 40% by weight at this moment in time. Another key factor is that they want to reach zero waste and HP operations by 2025. And they've got 87.7% landfill diversion rate globally. And we help HP achieve those numbers through our circularity program and through our recycling program that we've got at the various facilities around the world as well. What's also interesting, eliminating 75% of single-use plastic packaging by 25 compared to 2018. And what's interesting is that from our point of view, through our consumer electronics business in South Lake, Dallas, we are now developing new packaging material and very well positioned as a packaging supplier to work with ISP, because we can do all the testing in-house and we can actually set the benchmark of what needs to be changed with regards to the packaging required for the consumer electronics going forward for HP. So I think from our point of view, we're certainly well positioned to help HP and certainly take them on their journey. And not only just HP, but certainly other OEMs who we've reached out to and have reached out to us to look at very similar programs around their ESG targets. I think there's no doubt about it. The major OEMs are very ambitious in terms of what they want to achieve by 2030. Also, another case study, and I would suggest that please to download this presentation from certainly from the Closed Loop Group website to have a look at this press release in further detail. Quite recently, HP recognized Closed Loop with an award for the support for its HP certified program at a global provider conference in Las Vegas last month. You can see Sammy is on third on the right, receiving the award. And I think what actually happened at this particular award was that they also unveiled a new device life extension service. And what that means is that customers can now simply ship back their devices to their trusted HP partner. At the same time, HP introduced its first partner in the certified refurbishment program. And of course, they want to expand this PC refurbishment program into the US. And I just want to point out, we're talking about expanding into ITAD, i.e., consumer electronic products that are more than 1 year, sort of up to 1 year old, 2 years old, or 3 years old, and now starting to get these products back into the market. Closed Loop, I believe, is the ideal partner to do it with these, with HP. We've got, as I mentioned, we've got the facilities and we certainly have got the know-how. So if you look at it from an investment proposition, I think the circular economy is really in its infancy from where we see it. And only really a small percentage of these consumer electronics and plastics are being recovered. So there lies an opportunity for a closed loop. I think the volume of consumer electronics and plastics is really set to grow with regulatory and social pressure placed on the companies. And I think 2025 is a major key milestone in terms of the targets that we're seeing in different geographics around the world. And certainly with some of the big brands around the world that are insisting for circularity and insisting on repurposing and remanufacturing by 2025. Other parts of the world are looking at 2030, but brands themselves want to bring that number forward. I think Closed Loop, I've said it many times, are really well positioned in the circular economy and from a global perspective, and to be first to market. And I think that's due to our deep integration with the main OEMs and certainly a high level of product development innovation as well. So thank you very much for the opportunity for the whole team, for Mark and everybody to present here today. And we do welcome any questions that will come from the attendees. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Joe. We've got like 17 questions here now. They've been absolutely flying in since you were talking there. I just going to say up front, I don't think we're going to get to all these. So apologies to anybody who sent in questions here now. I will forward them on to Joe and the team, and hopefully they can maybe integrate some of the answers to these questions in their next presentation deck or next results. But I will pick out a few of them that I think are quite pertinent. One is, Joe, let's start with this one. How does the new revenue share HP contract impact close the loop's profitability versus the previous contract terms. Maybe just talk about that, just given how much of a relationship you have with HP. I think that's kind of quite an important one.
Okay, for sure. In fact, if you wouldn't mind, I'd like my colleague, Mark Lichtenstein, maybe just to answer that question on the on how it impacts the profitability of Close the Loop, and then I can take over from there. Thanks, Mark.
Okay, thank you, Joe. Well, certainly what it does is it improves our cash flow position very much so, and also improves our profitability in terms of the increased volumes that we see coming through. So now that we are the trusted partner with HP in that revenue share model, we're seeing increased volumes coming through the program. Also in terms of when we acquire, and there's another question that dealt with the inventory risk. We do take on the inventory risk associated with that, but the amounts now in the revenue share model that we're paying for the inventory has reduced significantly. That's very important for us to understand. So whilst there's an inventory risk, the inventory risk is very low, and the value of the products that we're selling is now we're able to increase it and generate greater gross profit margins for both Close the Loop and for HP. Joe?
Yeah, thank you. I think Mark has answered it. For us, what it's done is really embedded us with HP. We came to HP with the opportunity around revenue share. And for us to work with HP at this deep level, it shows the commitment is there from both sides. It's like a strong partnership between both companies. Thank you.
Okay. And then we've kind of got two questions around Toner Plus, Joe. One is, where would you see Toner Plus in terms of impacting kind of the bottom line if we take a 3 to 5 year view? And the second part would be, is there scope for that product out of Australia? I know you've only got it up and running in Australia now, but, is there scope to take that product to Europe, the US? Maybe just touch on that.
Yeah, great question. Mark, so Toner Plus, we joke internally, is a 10-year overnight success. We've been supplying Toner Plus to the Australian market for the last 5 or 6 years. And certainly our objective quite clearly is to take it into North America. We are busy in North America. We actually supply what we call toner pave to a Californian asphalt company already. We're supplying in excess of 3,000 tons of that product. And we are busy doing a whole set of trials. In fact, we're working with the University of Nevada at this moment in time to look at qualifications of the toner plus material in North America. From a revenue point of view, just to put it in perspective, Mark, we made a $5 million investment in this state-of-the-art equipment from Australia. And we would expect in one calendar year to generate revenue of about $4.8 million with about a $1 million EBITDA level on one single plant. We would see in 2 or 3 years' time, our wish list would be around about 5, 6, or even 7 plants across Australia. The market is there, and I saw there was a question about, is there an interest in Toner Plus? Certainly, the asphalt additive companies, our big partner, Downer, is actually waiting for us to supply the volumes that they need to fulfill the requirements they have for the asphalt in the roads here in Australia.
Okay. Then we got a question around acquisitions. Can you give maybe a bit more detail in terms of size, funding options for those? And I'm guessing, what segments within the business they might fall into, or maybe geographic regions that they might fall into.
I think naturally, and I'll let Mark comment on the funding side, if that's okay. I think geographically, certainly North America is the area where we see a lot of opportunities within the resource recovery. However, we're always looking at opportunities that come our way. We also go hunting for opportunities, there's no doubt about it. But the space that we see a lot of growth in the near future is within the ITAD space, the refurbishment and the remanufacturing of consumer electronics, there's no doubt about it. The size of the acquisition, certainly, I think if we look at benchmarking the ISP acquisition, I think we would look to something that really moves the needle in terms of our positioning in the market. And from a funding perspective, I think, Mark, I'm sure you'll comment on that one, please.
Yeah, from a funding perspective, we have, the business produces strong free operating cash flow. So in the first instance, we'd look to fund any acquisitions out of the free operating cash flows that we generate. We also have a lender that's willing to provide additional funding for the right acquisition opportunities. And I'll qualify and expand on what Joe says. We're certainly not a roll-up, and any acquisition we make is really about expanding our service offering that fits within the circular economy and can be circularly integrated into our business. So the funding is available for the right acquisition, but at the moment, you know, the business produces strong free operating cash flows. So it'd be a matter of potentially reinvesting some of those free cash flows for the right opportunity when it presents itself.
And then I think I'll put a broader question. There's a kind of individual questions around this, but it's on a kind of a capital allocation kind of theme, if I'll say that. And I don't know if Mark or Joe wanted it, but, you know, just on taking some of that cash flow and like where it's going to be applied by the board, whether that's, you know, refinancing debt to like acquisitions to potentially buybacks, you know, just given the market we've been in for microcaps more broadly. Maybe just touch on that and, you know, where you guys are kind of thinking or where the board is thinking in terms of a capital allocation policy or standing at the present moment in time.
Joe, if I can answer that one. At this moment in time, capital management is very important for us as a board and as a group. The first instance is to reduce our debt position. We have significant free cash flows. You'll see our net debt position has decreased substantially in the first half of this financial year. The comment has been branded about share buybacks and other capital management opportunities. For us, everything's on the table, but probably the most prudent opportunity for the moment is to reduce our debt facility. And I see there was another question that also dealt with the refinancing of the debt, and that's certainly something that is on the agenda for close the loop going forward. We have said that we need what we call a clean set of numbers, which is a set of financial statements with no acquisitions that includes the ISP acquisition for a full 12-month period, demonstrates the new position, if I can call it that, of the close the loop group. And with that and those audited accounts and those new numbers, it puts us in a very strong position to reduce some of the debt with the free cash flows that we have and potentially refinance with other financial institutions. But all options are on the table for capital management that are being considered by the board and working out what's in the best interests of shareholders as a whole.
Yeah, perfect. Joe, maybe one for you. Question here. You mentioned commodity prices were recovering from last year's lows. Just a question around, you know, what are the commodity price exposures that is, you know, Close the Loop has in terms of reselling those recycled end products?
But we're very fortunate that the commodity prices doesn't have a major effect on the overall Close the Loop business. If you look at the business that gets involved with the commodity-based commodity business, it's a very small proportion. I think it's under 10%. I think Mark will nod his head whether I'm incorrect or not. Thanks, Mark. Under 10%. So, like for instance, within the packaging space, you know, the cost of the raw materials is only a portion. It's probably about 35 to 40% of the overall selling price of the packaging material. The commodities that we make as a result of our recycling of our print consumables is a very, very small proportion of our business. If anything, it's a bonus selling those materials. So the main business is really the closed loop plastics in North America and the paper recycling business, which we've now seen, as I said, we've seen an uplift in that space as well. So I think we're very fortunate to see the change that's taken place over the last, I think, 2 or 3 months.
And then I think this is an important one, Joe, and I know we are gone over time, so I'll maybe make this the last one. A question around IP rights in regards to, you know, technology across the business in terms of, you know, what has Close the Loop got its hands on and has developed internally versus, you know, taking technology processes, you know, from you know, different providers, but there's IP sitting in how you get all of that to work together in an actual process and an actual chain. So maybe just talk about that if you could, please.
Yeah, for sure. I think what's interesting is that the traditional closed loop business has developed the IP for let's call it the last 20 plus years. I mean, there's certainly IP around handling toner. There's IP within the tonoplast. There's IP within the facility of physically breaking down these materials as well. And even within the ISP Tech Services, the previous owner developed specialized IP to be able to handle multiple units in terms of cleaning them to the Department of Defense specification. And of course, we've got very interesting sort of IP around the reverse logistics. I mean, and providing data back to the OEMs. I mean, that data is so valuable that it, you know, like for instance, we would record every single item that comes through our facilities in America, Belgium, or in Australia, and that data is critical back to the OEM as to where the product has come from, how much tone is still left in the product. What is the volumes of these materials? What is the number of SKUs and so forth? That doesn't happen overnight. So there's actually quite a lot. So the barrier to entry across a number of the businesses would be pretty high from that point of view. I'm not sure whether Mark wants to add on to that, because Mark was obviously quite involved in the closed loop business for some time before I got involved.
Yes, thank you, Joe. The closed loop business actually has 4 patents that sit across the different technologies across the group. These are global patents. So there's a patent over the toner plas product. There's a patent over the extraction of the toner from the cartridges, which is the print consumables recycling. And there's a couple other patents that we have in place. So Joe is spot on in that there's a lot of knowledge and know-how across the group and across the organization that's been developed over a 20-year period. But this is also underpinned by 4 basic patents that sit across the resource recovery side of the business.
Gentlemen, I think we'll leave it there because we've gone about 5 minutes over time. I do want to respect kind of everybody's time, but apologies again if I didn't get to your question. We had 21 questions to try and get through there in the 10 minutes, which was difficult, so I tried to pick out as a broad a subset as I could. Joe, thank you very much for joining us. Indeed, Mark, thank you very much for joining us as well. Hopefully it won't be so long in between drinks before we have closed the loop back on again. I know it's taken us a bit of time to fit this into Joe's calendar particularly, but it was great to get an update on the business, and we'll keep an eye on the ASX for further updates and announcements and results, and maybe we'll get you on in the second half of 20 calendar year 24.
Thanks very much.
Thanks everybody. That concludes this morning's session. We've only got the one company, and we've got another event happening next week for anybody who wants to join us. Then we've got SKS Technologies who will be on here next Thursday morning. And with that, I wish everybody a good rest of their Thursday. Thank you.